We're here at the Centre for Computing History, and it's my great pleasure to welcome Ian Williamson. Ian, please tell us who you are and what you do at the moment.
Right. Well, I've sort of had a long career, but I know you want to start a bit before the career itself.
Mm-hmm.
So I was born in Oldham in Lancashire in 1951. And I was brought up in a pretty humble background. So many, many years before we had a toilet inside the house. But that was the way people lived in those days. So this was a working class home. My father had trained as a fitter in engineering. But when I remember him, he'd moved on to be a sales and service engineer for Hoover. Basically, going and repairing people's Hoovers and using the opportunity to sell them a new one along the way. And he was doing that probably until I was in my very early teens, 11 or so, and he was made redundant, and then he was made redundant again, and then he was made redundant again. And he finished up back where he started in the engineering industry as a machinist. The rest of my family, the male members, it's not a large family, I had a couple of uncles, both of them were, you know, engineers, again in the mechanical sense of fitters, and my rich uncle, rich because he travelled a lot and had good expenses, was an outfitter for plaits and the textile machinery, which is the core of the engineering in the Northwest. So that was the background. We lived in a relatively deprived area of Oldham. Oldham now you would recognise as being a very deprived town, but the decline had not really started. But the area we lived in was not well off in any sense. But it had a school with one of these truly exceptional headmasters, and he worked very hard to pick out children that he felt had potential. So in junior school, the year before we finished, probably when we were about 10 years old, he would pick out the children he thought had a chance of winning scholarships. And for an hour after school, he'd cram us, you know, sort of. So, you know, sort of it was a, and it was such a well, it became such a well-known school, the classic, probably early postcode lottery before postcodes existed, but the teachers in the town used to transfer their own kids to the school. You know, so you got all these sort of middle class kids coming into this working class school because the headmaster had such a good reputation. And at 11, come 11 plus time, you know, sort of off we went on a bus to take the exams to the local direct grant schools. And I did all right. I got a scholarship to Manchester Grammar School. And Manchester Grammar is, at the time, was probably outside of the Edens and Harrows, the best school, grammar school you could go to.
What was your vision then at that time? I mean, did you have any idea about what you wanted to do or what your interests were?
No, I always had an interest in making things and building things and playing with bits of electrical kit and buzzers and lights and things like that. So it was pretty clear I was going to do sciences. And actually Manchester Grammar forces that issue. You know, these are the days of selective education. So you, at 11, you were streamed either modern or classics. You know, so literally you're making your decision. Or somebody's making a decision for you at 11 years old. I'm not entirely sure I made the decision. But, you know, so I found myself, you know, sort of travelling by bus to Manchester Grammar. It was something like 11 miles and three buses. Pretty challenging for an 11-year-old kid.
You're doing it on your own?
Yeah, sort of. Now, my sister, who's sort of just short of 3 years older than me, had sort of almost blazed the trail because she'd been to the same school and she'd won a scholarship at Manchester High School, which is the next-door school. My parents were very reluctant to let her go, and the headmaster, Mr. Farrer, kind of prevailed upon them. You know, you can't not take this opportunity. So when it was my turn, they were reluctant. My mother was reluctant to let me go, but the same process went on, which is you can't deny him this opportunity. And so there were quite a crowd of kids making the journey. You know, sort of it was, so it, you know, it seemed you wouldn't consider it now. You know, the idea that you're going to send an 11-year-old boy on three buses, you know, sort of 11 miles there and back every day, you know, sort of it just wouldn't have been contemplated. But, you know, at the time as children, we had much more freedom in the 1960s.
There's also the transition, isn't there, going from the junior school to the senior school. And then also, if you're talking about coming from working class background and then going to a grant-funded school, did you notice an impact there or a difference?
Oh, yeah. See, I mean, I didn't enjoy my education one bit. And I was socially bullied mercilessly. It was full of affluent middle-class kids. But, I mean, the main source of the bullying was actually the staff. And, you know, I mean, it was... And I'm not going to put these things on record, but, you know, sort of it was... the class system was much more a feature of life in the early 1960s. And I would have spoken quite differently, you know, sort of... And that was used and abused, you know, and so it was not in any sense a nice experience at all. It's funny because you know I get the newsletter from Manchester Grammar appealing for money, and you know I give a lot of money away, but I don't give it to Manchester Grammar because I don't have fond memories of this experience there at all. But I was, you know. I had a propensity to do well in examinations, so you know, sort of I was able to comfortably cruise along, knowing that come the final part of the year there'd be an examination and I'd do all right, you know, sort of. So it was a, you know, sort of I got through the school, Manchester Grammar was a. Had tram tracks laid from Manchester to Cambridge and Oxford. So something like half the, not quite half, but probably 40% of the boys at the school went on to Oxbridge. And the whole curriculum was geared to achieving that. So you took your O-levels a year early. So you entered sixth form effectively at 15. And you picked your three, so you picked, or the school picked, the three subjects that you were going to do.
What were yours then?
Well, mine were, you know, maths, physics and chemistry, so completely traditional. And then I did S levels in maths and physics. And you took all those exams a year early, at 17, which meant that you could apply for Oxbridge with grades established and also, you know, sit the entrance exam and so on. So the whole thing was designed to put you in a preferential condition for, you know, entry to Oxbridge.
Where did you want to go?
Anywhere but. I fought the system and said I wasn't prepared to do the last year at school, that I wanted to leave at 17. I wanted to do a student apprenticeship. I wanted to work for a year before I went on to do my, you know, sort of, you know, degree. And I wanted to go to a place where there were girls. And this was, you know, just completely unacceptable. They said, like, where? So I said, well, Southampton or Bristol or Manchester or, you know, anywhere, but not, you know, in a place where there's like one girl for every 20. You know, undergraduates, and I want to go to a normal place and have a normal life. And so my form teacher and the careers teacher absolutely resisted this. It was totally unacceptable. But I was adamant. I mean, I was a fairly bolshy young man. I was quite adamant I wasn't going to do it. I was going to be an engineer, and I was going to go and work, and then I was going to go and do my you know, engineering degree. And so I had to go for an interview with the High Master, who was ever so posh. And, you know, because it needed his permission to let me do what I wanted to do in my life. I mean, that was the way it operated. And I will put this on the record because it's one of, it was hilarious. I mean, it's almost like a Monty Python sketch. Because he went in, he said, "Well, I hear you don't want to go to Oxbridge, you know, why ever not? It's a wonderful place." But, you know, so I did my bit about, you know, sort of wanting to be with real people in the real world, and I was going to be an engineer and so on. And then he said, you know, "Have you ever played, do you play golf?" And it's like, and of course, he's immediately, you know, sort of picking at the very reasons why I wanted to get out of this, you know, sort of. The idea of playing golf from my background was, you know, nobody played golf. I mean, it was ridiculous. And then, you know, sort of, do squash after school. And it's like, no, I live 13 miles away. It takes me an hour and a quarter to get home. You know, I don't stay after school. It's not possible. Can't your parents pick you up? And then the final and the killer was, have you been on foreign trek? And at Manchester Grammar, you know, they go away to the Himalayas or whatever for 6 weeks. And again, the idea that my parents could afford something like that was just ludicrous. You know, it was, in those days, it was about £60. You know, my father was probably earning £16 a week. And it was just, he was just so disconnected with the world. And at the end of it, you know, sort of, he said, "Yes, well," he said, probably. "It might be right for you not to go to Oxbridge." And he actually gave me permission, you know, sort of not to go and to leave school. You know, sort of at the end of, you know, the academic year at 17. So I get a full year, you know, working at GEC. So I'll finish that story and then we'll move on to the decision. So I took my A-levels and, you know, sort of I was all set. I'd left the school. I'd said goodbye to everybody. I'd applied and got a job, which we'll talk about in a moment. And then the results came through and I got the best results in the school, which they'd never expected. So I got 3 A's and 2 1's, and which was unusual in those days before grade inflation. And they obviously realised that I had an absolute certain position at Oxford and Cambridge. And, you know, the primary issue is to keep up there in the league tables. So my form master rings my parents and said, "Were Ian to get an invitation to an interview, will you pay for his bus fare to go?" And, I mean, talk about pressure, you know. They said, "Well, of course we'd pay for his bus fare, but he doesn't want to go." They said, well, let's see if they're interested. And, you know, within a couple of days, I had a letter inviting me for an interview at Christ College here in Cambridge. So I came on the bus. And memory plays funny tricks. I mean, I didn't want to be here. But it must have been in August. But my memory is of a wet, miserable, damp, dark Cambridge, you know, sort of. And, you know, I've often thought since that it's not at all clear that my memory matches the reality. And I was interviewed at Christ by, I think, Grenstead or Gren... I think he was the director of admissions. And the lecturer in engineering, who was Dr. Biggs, became Professor Biggs in due course. Both of them saying, "Well, why on earth don't you want to come?" You know, and with Biggs, I got a few more questions around fracture mechanics in bouncing bombs, which was what he worked on in the war. But you know, I went through the interview. I got some promises from them that I would never have to go to chapel, never have to say grace, and never have to have dinner at the college, which came back to haunt me. But you know, sort of the, you know, and I would have a normal life, you know, sort of. And in fact, Grenstead said he could fix everything for me except the girls. I'd have to do that by myself. And then a couple of days later, literally got the offer of a place. And it was arranged I'd go back into school to discuss it. And I walked in and I realised, and I've never forgotten, what peer pressure is like. I was quite determined not to accept this place. Every boy in the school wanted the place, and I was walking in with the place and was quite determined to turn it down. And it's amazing the degree to which nobody in authority could have made me change my mind, but the sort of 20 boys I'd been in a class with were much more effective, saying, you can't walk away from it, you know, you can't not do it, and so on. So I finished up, stayed a few more weeks, and took the Cambridge entrance exam and failed it. But what did I have to prove at that point? Failed it, and then left to start my career as an engineer. Mm-hmm. So that's the school story behind it. I guess probably we should go back and talk about influence, choosing electronics, and things of that nature.
Well, I'm quite interested in you're rejecting the school and the university. What were you looking for? What did you want to do, and what did you apply for?
I'd applied for the engineering sciences triplets. I'd already decided I was going to be an engineer. And I already decided I was going to be an electronics engineer. So I had a very clear view of what my career was going to be by that point. And it's to the school's credit that they gave me the exposure that let me make that decision. The career path, in a sense, was already mapped out. It was simply that I found myself in the rarefied environment of a Cambridge college rather than where I expected to be, which was at Southampton or Bristol. I have to say that the actual experience in the Faculty of Engineering at Cambridge was excellent. And obviously you never know because you don't go to the other university, but I suspect was no different. I mean, I think probably at that time and probably now, any of the Russell Group universities were delivering excellent engineering degrees. The Cambridge degree moved quicker because you got through pretty much a full broad engineering syllabus in 2 years, and then you specialised in the last year. And the Cambridge experience is marked by being, frankly, horrendously competitive because of this selection process. Everybody who's on the course with you was top of their school. I was probably the one that wasn't. So there's this, you've got a whole series of young men who've had an experience of always being the best. They find themselves at Cambridge and they're not the best anymore. And one of my good friends, had been, at a school in Stafford, and he'd been, head boy and captain of rugger and, best results in the class. He had to work so hard to get a third, just to stay in there. So, as a university education, what characterized it then was the degree of competitiveness within.
Was there a shift in terms of the snobbery in the class system, in terms of your perception from school to university?
I'd learned to handle it a lot better. And at that time, Cambridge was very meritocratic in terms of the entry. Some of the colleges still, would have predominantly Eton, and so on. But certainly Christ wasn't like that at all. So the social makeup of the people I was doing engineering with was not unlike my own. And there wasn't the same sort of snobbery or social separation that I experienced. I mean, where it was visible was some undergraduates were tangibly so much better off. But I actually had reached a point by 18 where, by good luck and in the main, a bit of work, but, you know, I got myself ahead of the other students. You know, I had support from GEC and I'd earned money before I went to college, and, you know, so I was actually, you know, I could always afford a beer at the end of the week, whereas, you know, not always was that possible, you know, sort of.
So I'm not too sure then, you've got the school, you've got university, where does GEC then come in?
Right, well, I decided whilst I was, when I started to study for my A-levels, so at 16, that I was going to be an engineer and I wanted to do a thick, what was called a thick sandwich course, where you had 1 year in industry, 3 years at university and 1 year in industry. And at that time, the larger engineering companies offered thick sandwich courses. They also offered thin sandwich courses where you did 6 months at work and 6 months in college. Mostly those were the new technological universities like Loughborough and Brunel. And it was a much more integrated training process. So I applied. I wanted to be an electronics engineer. I applied to GEC, AEI, Marconi, English, which was English Electric, and Ferranti. And I got offers from GEC, AEI, English Electric. But actually, Ferranti, which was on my doorstep, I got the offer and was sent for the medical, and they turned me down because I've got a lazy eye, and they had a works doctor who was adamant that you couldn't do microelectronics unless you had 20/20 vision. So so Ferranti sort of pulled their offer, and my mother was intensely upset because all the others involved me in living in London and Chelmsford and Rugby, whereas if I'd gone to Ferranti, I could have stayed at home, but I was quite keen not to stay at home. So it suited me to be turned down by Ferranti. So I had a choice. I chose GEC. I applied. I was interviewed by what was called GEC Applied Electronics Laboratory. It was at Stanmore, on the north side of London. And it had been set up as an applied electronics facility attached to the Hurst Research Laboratories in Wembley. It was one of those lucky choices, you know, sort of it, because it turned out to be a star place to be trained when I eventually got there. But I'd accepted it in when I was sort of probably, you know, around about my 17th birthday or thereabouts. So I had a very clear view I was going to train with them, and then I was going to go to a university, Southampton. And then I was going to finish up starting my career as an electronics engineer with them, which I did. The only thing that got in the way was I went to Cambridge as opposed to Southampton. And it was we'll talk more about it, but it was a very good experience. I was extraordinarily lucky in the interactions I had. And being still poor and funding myself completely, I worked a lot. So, you know, I went back every year and worked through the holidays as well as, you know, every week available up until starting college and starting work immediately I left college because there was no choice. I mean, there was no other, you know, source of money to keep myself. It was a good experience.
Did they hold a place open for you then specifically to allow you to come back and work during the during the holiday periods?
Yeah. I'd say I'll be back for 8 weeks, you know, in July and August, and it was good. And they paid me, you know, so they would pay me when I was back and they'd find an assignment for me. And my luck is in the assignments I had through that period, which I'm sure we'll talk about in
due course. Touch on now. I mean, what sort of assignments were you doing?
Well, probably the most the biggest stroke of luck is I walk in to start the job completely untrained, I was assigned to a senior engineer who was developing the grand name, the command and control system for the ground terminal systems for the original Telstar aerial at Goonhilly. So you're of an age where you remember Telstar and all the excitement around Telstar, the very first satellite transmissions and the sort of Tomorrow's World program, the breathless wait for when the satellite came over the horizon and the very first television pictures that were transmitted by satellite. And that's around 61, 62, something like that. That equipment was life expired by 1969. And so the post office, general post office as it then was, had paid, had put out a contract for a completely new set of electronics to equip the original Telstar antenna at Goonhilly for the Intelsat 3 and 4 satellites, which were then, Intelsat 3 was then operating over the Atlantic, and they'd launched a new satellite for the Pacific and the Indian Ocean. And the mission of the Goonhilly 1 antenna was to track the Indian Ocean antenna. And the new Goonhilly 2 was on the Atlantic, Intelsat. And so a satellite ground station at that time was still unrecognizable to us today. On one side of the antenna, I mean, this is a 90-foot antenna, fully steerable. On one side of the antenna was the transmitter cabin, which, and the transmitter was 2 or 3 megawatts. I mean, it hummed a lot. I mean, being in there was quite frightening, especially when the antenna was deployed, because there was no way out. And this thing's humming away at you, you know, sort of. And on the other side of the antenna was another cabin, slung off the dish, which had the receiver that was cooled with liquid nitrogen. And you know, the satellites at the time had so little power on board from their solar panels, which weren't deployed as big arrays, you know, that the signal coming back was so weak that you could only detect it with a 90-foot antenna and liquid nitrogen cooled, you know, sort of detector. And on the other side of it, to get the satellite to hear you, you were pumping out, you know, 2 or 3 megawatts into this antenna. And this is, you know, microwaves were understood by then, and the damage they did was understood. But the Goonhilly is right by where the helicopter training is down in Cornwall. And the helicopter pilots used to play around in front of the antenna, you know, sort of. And people, you know, really, you didn't want to go within 100 yards of that beam because it was pretty powerful, you know, sort of microwaves. So, and then it would be brought back through a lot of equipment to bring it down, you know, modulators, demodulators, take it up. I mean, broadly, these transmissions were running at about 4 gigahertz, which is about as high as you would ever go in, you know, those days. And so, you know, they were, you know, all the signals were being brought together, taken up, you know, sort of for the transmitter, and then brought back down again. Racks of equipment to achieve this. And equipment was not very reliable, so everything was duplicated, and everything was switchable. The waveguide switches, so you lost the transmitter, it would switch within 40 milliseconds. And it would detect the loss and then it would turn. And the command and control system was there to run that automatic switching function so that you got a reliable television signal or a reliable voice transmission.
What was your role then? So you come in as a new employee.
Well, the senior engineer was an expert in digital logic. And he designed the system which was going to do all the switching using the newfangled diode transistor logic semiconductor circuits. And a year before it would have been transistors and diodes, all discrete. And so he designed a modular set of components that were kind of bistable units that remembered where everything was, and then there was logic boards that took the various combination of fault signals and worked out what you were going to do with this big radio set. And they'd all been designed. They were being manufactured. So he got a student who knew nothing. So he gave me all the circuit diagrams and he said, I want you to write test schedules for these. Work out what they do and write a series of test schedules that allow us to test them. In his own mind, he thought this was 8 weeks of work. So 3 days later, I went back and said, I've done it. And I said, you can't have to show me, you know. So he went through it and said, yeah, no, this is right, you've done it. You know, so he said, well, he said, we're getting the first modules next week. He said, why don't you test them? So I sat down and tested them. So they're all manufactured and I just sat there and worked through my test sequences and tested everything and learned about digital logic, DTL integrated circuits, and you know the way you could deploy them to make these control systems. So we're in early 1969, when this is happening.
So why was it so easy for you to do? Are you just a particular genius, or is it something that you had an aptitude for?
well, I'm not a genius, but it was one of these strokes of good fortune, because when I'd been at school, and this is one of the very good things about the school, is one of the physics teachers had contacts with the university and worked, I think, you know, just out of interest with the Manchester University computer group. And Manchester, Imperial, Cambridge, and possibly Oxford attached to Harwell was just about it for computers in the 1960s. He had made, either at the university or with the university, a little demonstrator of what a digital processor is, using transistors, little miniature lights, little push buttons. And for a kind of open day when I was doing my O-levels, the kind of science department showed what it could do for boys choosing their A-levels. And I went along and there was this digital processor. It was an 8-bit X register, an 8-bit accumulator, and a little Boolean logic function. And I was absolutely, I mean, I talked about it when we launched Odyssey here last year. It was instant. I mean, I just looked at this thing and that was it. I was going to do this, you know, because the world became digital to me. And you know, so I played around, you know, looking at and thinking about, you know, digital logic, you know, during my A-level. And this little demonstrator unit didn't work very well. There's this thing about digital circuits in those days is they were plagued by electrical noise. And, you know, you don't think that you're going to get noise in digital circuits, but boy, do you get noise. And it was switching little tiny inductive bulbs. And, of course, they were sending spikes back through the circuit. So it was a great idea, but it didn't actually work. So within a month or two, it was sort of abandoned in a sort of room somewhere in the physics department. And I had picked it up and tried to get it working, you know, sort of whilst I was in the sixth form. So I had some knowledge of digital logic, of what was going on in computers, from that experience. And that, for me, it's one of those, it's very, very clear where I decided, I was interested in electronics, but the point where I decided that my future was with digital electronics was, you know, when I was 15 in this physics department, where this teacher produced a demonstrator based on his, you know, evening involvement with the Manchester University computer department. So I was just serendipity. I walk in to, you know, sort of a project that involves, you know, the most advanced digital electronics that was probably being undertaken in the country at the time. So I did my 6 or 8 weeks I think it was due to be 8 weeks as an assignment, and I tested all the units. And then it appears quite clear that something's going very wrong with the project at Goonhilly. They are way behind time, and they're on quite serious penalties. I mean, these satellite ground stations were generating revenues on an unbelievable scale for the GPO. You know, transatlantic phone calls were just incredibly expensive. And I mean, they were talking about 600,000 or £1 million of revenue a day. And GEC was running late. And so there was a bit of all hands, you know, and they said, no, you're not moving. And will you go to Goonhilly and work on the commissioning? You know, when you take all this, you know, sort of digital logic and actually apply it in situ. It was a godsend for me because I kind of left home. I had no financial support. I was earning £9 a week and paying for myself in London. And my digs were £5.10. My bus fares were over £1. You know, I didn't have any money. And, you know, the digs were a real problem and they weren't feeding me. So I was in desperate straits. It really was the only time in my life I've been hungry, really hungry. And then they say, will you go and live in a hotel and do this work in Goonhilly? And it's like, too right, I will, you know, so off I go. And we spend, you know, something like 4 weeks working all hours of the day and night to try and get this thing working again. And the control system didn't work in the real world environment. When you got all of the associated electrical noise being surrounded by these powerful radio signals all around the place, inducing stray currents, you know, this sensitive sort of switching stuff was switching at random. You know, so you'd be there and then bang, 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 the waveguides switches would go and you've suddenly, you know, you've switched off the transmitter, you've turned on the wrong receiver and you've changed the crystals in the demodulator, you know. So we were going around tacking capacitors on all the terminals to try and suppress noise. It was chaos. And then I'm in the control room. There's a big American guy over and, you know, he was in the control room just looking around. And the satellite over the Atlantic failed. And so he takes control and it's one of these everybody's shushes. The control room is a bit like... you know, it's a huge room with all these sort of control bays, a bit like the, you know, Starship Enterprise, you know, sort of. And he's, you know, the Captain Kirk character, and he's talking on a landline, a subsea cable line to, you know, the counterpart in Boston. And he keeps calling for 3 dB more power. And then this, you know, sort of Cornish guy goes, we're already at 5 MW, mate. Sort of, you ain't got another 3 dB, you know. And, you know, sort of at which point he says, well, that bird's dead. So, you know, they've lost the satellite over the Atlantic, which was the new Intelsat 4, I think. And so, you know, at that point, you know, everything goes quiet for a while. We go back to our normal work. And then we get this instruction saying, everything you've done has got to be taken out. Because we're going to redirect, there are no television signals that can get across the Atlantic. So we're going to bring them the other way around the world from America. We're going to take them across the Pacific, microwave towers across Australia. Somehow they were going to get to Japan by a subsea cable. Then they were going to go across the Indian Ocean back to the UK. The reason being that it was the Prince of Wales investiture. And they'd sold the television rights for a huge amount of money. And, you know, sort of they basically had to find a way to get them there. So they said to GEC, forget your original contract. You've got 36 hours to reconfigure this big radio set to get these television signals for the live transmission of the Prince of Wales investiture. So we worked the 36 hours. I mean, the first thing I did was rip everything I'd done out. And the next thing I did was fetched and carried for this old engineer, remarkable skill, who literally retuned everything so that they could carry these signals the wrong way around the world. And then on the during the transmission, you know, I was actually up in that transmitter cabin for like 3 hours, you know, sort of, and fortunately, you know, sort of 17 years old, you've got a good strong bladder, you know, sort of, because my job was if the thing went down, I had to turn the wave guide manually, you know, sort of, so it was all, that was the way it was done. And that's how the Prince of Wales Investiture was a live transmission around the world. It was done by re-rigging this radio set at Goonhilly to achieve it. 2 weeks after that, the same rig up was used to bring the moon landing back to the UK. It came through this completely bird's nest of a, you know, sort of experimental system that had been put together in 36 hours. You know, they left it, they just left it alone. You know, and the first steps on the moon were shown live in the UK, courtesy of this bodge-up.
Have to be there again?
No, I mean, obviously, I presume the GP, you know, GPO engineers just did the bit of sitting in the cabin, you know, on standby. but, you know, so I watched it, you know, sort of back in London. But this was, I mean, a fabulous experience for a very first piece of work experience. Post office were so pleased that they managed to rescue these two big television events that they must have paid some sort of contractual bonus to GEC, because a few weeks later I was called into the office and thanked for my work and given a £100 bonus. And, you know, bear in mind, £9 a week pay, you know, this was transformational for me. You know, so I went off to college flush with savings for the first time in my life. From the experience of working, you know, on this fantastic, you know, project. But that actually sealed things, really. I mean, from then on, there's, you know, there never really been any question, but now there was, that was it. There was no question. I was completely hooked, you know, on that technology and working in that area. And they respected that. They moved me. The next project I worked on there was digital computer modelling. I was involved in simulation of, let's say, a submersible vehicle, but you know, it was using the big supercomputer at Imperial College, and you know, I wasn't involved in writing the mathematical model that did the emulation, but I was involved. Well, my job was to put in the data, send it away every night, and then analyze the tracks and then change some of the parameters associated with it.
What was the computer they had, the supercomputer they had at the time? Can you remember?
Yeah, I can't actually remember. We built 3 or 4 supercomputers in this country, and I can't remember what their code name for them was. And to say that, I think there were 4 of them in the country at the time. I mean, incredibly expensive to use. I sent off a punch tape reel every night, and the following morning by courier I get back, you know, sort of the folded paper in the box. I'd get 2 boxes of that with all of the information. And I'd work through it, code a new set of results, and then send it away. I think it was about £1,000 a run. And there was one night when I clearly got it wrong, because this particular submersible vehicle kind of did this and then came out of the water, and that was the end of the run. that was an expensive mistake.
Can I be clear about this? You prepared punched tapes.
Yeah.
They were then sent physically. From where to where?
From Stanmore into, I presume the computer was in Imperial College. It was at Imperial College.
Right.
In a basement somewhere.
They'd generate the data as paper sheets, which would then be brought
to you. No, they would take the punch tape data instructions. The program was already there, and they would run it. They'd get 2 boxes of computer printout, which would then come back for analysis, and then we'd run another simulation.
Physical out and physical back at that time.
Yeah. At that time.
Amazing.
And, you know, sort of the... So, you know, I had the high-tech bit, which we've got here in the museum, you know, which is the machine where, you know, you basically enter the data and clack, 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 the punch tape. takes it on, produces the reel. And interestingly, above where I worked on that point was one of the biggest UK-based analog computers. And, until you'd seen one, difficult to believe. These were for simulating missiles. So, essentially you had row after row of, operational amplifiers where you could adjust inductance, capacitance, and resistance, mass, that you could then plug together. The analog computer occupied, three or four racks, 12 foot long, 6 foot high. The operational amplifiers were valve-based. They were Class A valve-based amplifiers. The heat from it was incredible. It would have taken them something like 6 months to program that analog computer to do the digital simulations. But it would then have been able to do all the simulations that I ran over about an 8 week period, in about a day. But the time to actually plug everything and tune everything was just incredible, and the skill to do it was incredible. So up until these very first supercomputers came online, that's the only way that you could do it. And I guess, literally a decade before that, you simply didn't do it. You built the missile or the whatever it was, and you fired it, and you looked where it went, and then adjusted the wings a little bit, see if you could make it go differently. Mm-hmm. So, it was the start of what we now take for granted in terms of our ability to model everything. Mm-hmm. At the time, we couldn't, and it was only the military that had the resources to contemplate that type of technology.
If we're looking at that sort of computing capability at that time, what sort of device would compare to that nowadays?
Broadly, even at that level of supercomputer, the computing power in my phone exceeds it.
The computing power in your current phone exceeds?
Current phone exceeds that by a country mile. By a country mile. The simulations that were being done, they probably were taking an hour of CPU time to run. And, frankly, they wouldn't even count as a computer game in today's world. I get a bit more comfortable talking computing power a few years later, but there's no doubt that, what I was getting out from that exercise, was probably more akin to what you were seeing with some of the early Space Invader games rather than what you would see in anything nowadays. So, very difficult to... bear in mind that the lunar lander, the computer was equivalent to the very first programmable calculator. This would have been at least £1 million supercomputer at the time, and the pound was worth a lot more then. Very different world.
So you're at university, you keep on going back, you come back, but at some point you're coming to the end of your studies. Was there anything particular that was special about the last year when you specialised?
I started to get very interested in coding. Not coding in the sense of programming. Mm-hmm. Coding in the sense of data compression, data manipulation. Partly it was my tutor at Christ, Pete Rayner. And it did seem that was a necessary route to enable some of this technology to become real world. That by using the embedded redundancy within digital coding, that you could tolerate more noise and extract more data from the available signal. So, you know, that became an interest. And I did actually... Cambridge wanted me to stay after my degree. And I did agree to come back and do a PhD in digital algorithms, digital coding, digital modelling. But I wanted to go back and do at least a year at what was then been renamed Marconi, because GEC had bought everybody else. And, you know, I felt a commitment to go back and do that year with them. So I left Cambridge with my place to come back and do a PhD, and my interest was in digital coding. In fact, the project I started doing with when I was back with Marconi was, in fact, there were two projects that I was working on. One was the very first weather satellites, and I was doing the project to identify exactly where they were. So it's kind of the reverse of GPS. So I was designing the ground stations and did a very interesting piece of work, basically tracking, you know, how to range a geostationary satellite and identify exactly where it was, so you could know exactly what the picture was showing you from the satellite. And I also worked on a man-portable satellite communicator, a military project. But it had a 3-foot diameter disc. Of course, there was no signal in those days. So I was actually using quite advanced digital coding to get what amounts to a telex type signal out of the mush that you were getting from carrying this little thing and setting it up and so on. So, you know, I was doing some interesting projects when I got back. So I deferred the start for my PhD by a year, and then I decided I wasn't going to do the PhD and didn't come back, which was absolutely, with hindsight, the right decision, you know. So I stayed in the end for 2 to 3 years with Marconi.
Mm-hmm. What prompted you then to leave Marconi?
Too much military work, and I was a bit idealistic, and I was being pulled inexorably into pretty hard military work in the wrong description. Broadly, I didn't really want to work on things that blew people up. I found that just a step too far. And I actually felt, in an idealistic sense, particularly given my background, that I wanted to work in areas that help create employment. I mean, this is a time of the first major recession, you know, the 3-day week and everything that went with it. I mean, difficult time in the UK, and I felt it was wrong that I'd been educated so expensively, and all I was doing was things that denied runways and things of that nature. So I deliberately looked for an environment where I could use my skills in a more commercial and a more useful sense, productively. I saw a job advertised by a company called Cambridge Recruitment Consultants. I applied for it. It wasn't a real job. The guy who ran Cambridge Recruitment Consultants was sort of semi-owned by Clive Sinclair, and he'd run one of these teaser ads to get people on his list and then see if he could place them. And he... so he got me. I was interviewed by Clive at the mill.
What was that like?
The unforgettable experience. Biggest office I'd seen until that time in my life. You know, you walk in and there's this, even then, slightly shiny bald head at the very far end of the room glinting the light back at you. He sort of had the whole top floor of the mill as his office, you know, and he sat behind this desk at the very end. It was an interesting job. He was recruiting me effectively to replace Nigel Searle, who'd done the algorithm development for the executive. And but you know, sort of, it was kind of like it didn't feel right. So, you know, I wasn't particularly taken with that opportunity or with Clive, really. at the time. I mean, I liked him, but I wasn't taken with the idea of working for him. The other placement that Jeffrey King arranged was with Cambridge Consultants. Mm-hmm. I was interviewed by Bob Hook for the Digital Systems Group, and I felt good about CCR. So I got an offer from CCR, and I took that. I moved to Cambridge, and CCL at the time was probably about 55 to 60 people strong. It was a bar hill. Very strange when you first go in, because there's an element of disorder about it. It still had a lot of the idiosyncrasies of Tim Iloart and the founders of CCL at the time. But it was a good environment. I enjoyed it. I mean, young company, young group of people, and some interesting opportunities. And it was there where almost immediately I was drawn into opportunities to use these newfangled microprocessors for real applications. And of course, it was natural from what I've been doing for me to do that, and something that wasn't difficult. The difficult issue at the time was nobody knew what they were for. I mean, you know, sort of they'd been invented and produced and marketed quite effectively by Intel, but nobody could figure out what on earth you use them for. My benefit was that I had this sort of experience with Goonhilly. I knew exactly what these things were used for. It was just a matter of finding the right applications, and then it's relatively straightforward to use them. So, you know, I got the opportunity to work on, you know, two or three projects with that technology, and, you know, sort of, and there was a lot more potential, a lot more that could be done with them. But another side of CCL was paper studies. There was a lot of work coming in from the European Space Agency. Again, there was a lot of work from the Ministry of Defence. So the same things that were pulling Marconi in this direction, away from commercial application, were there even in CCL. I would think by the time I left, probably half the work was originating in governmental type of bodies. We worked on some fun projects, and
is there a particular one that you can?
Yeah, there was one project which was to look at all the different ways of making digital systems fail-safe. We had a lot of fun with that project, and we did some good work. And essentially, it was to find ways of making the digital control systems on a satellite, you know, fail safely, or extend our life. And we were looking at alternatives to triple module redundancy and the you know, the established techniques. And that was a good project, because I was able to use digital system design approaches, coding, you know, technologies and so on, lots of good stuff. And it was a good project that we worked on, but it involved writing a massive report. And none of us were very good at writing. And the personnel director of CCO at the time was Rodney Dale. And Rodney is very good with words. He's a good wordsmith. He's a brilliant editor. He's an innovative writer. So he kind of took the project in hand and knocked it into shape. And I quite enjoyed the process of working with Rodney on that. Rodney introduced me to Tim Iloart, who'd founded CCL. And Tim was looking for somebody to write and to upgrade. He had some self-instruction courses that were sold through mail order to teach people about electronics and digital electronics and so on. And they were very out of date. He wanted them updated. He wanted a text on basic computer programming and so on. And he had a company called Cambridge Learning Enterprises, which he used to sell these products. So I started working with Rodney, with Tim, to upgrade the instruction courses and to write new ones.
What sort of time was this?
1975. Mm-hmm. And it was, so we generated quite a few textbooks in that period. And they sold quite well, and I was doing this, if you like, in the evening. And I got good royalties. I'm surprised how much I did earn. I actually found an account book, and it's quite good money. And I eventually actually bought the US business of Cambridge Learning Enterprises, and I had a friend who was living out in Boston, and he ran it from the US, and we sold the same courses in the US. So, you know, sort of with Rodney, you know, generated these self-instruction courses, and then Rodney and I branched out and did two or three other books as well, either the paperback and so on, you know, nice little sideline. It became very clear to me that there was an absolute thirst for knowledge about microprocessors. The technology had been hyped up. Anybody who was in electronics engineering realized this stuff was going to put them out of a job, and they needed to learn about it, but there was no way to learn about it. The US made kind of evaluation kits cost £200-£400. And probably average wage then was £30 or £40 a week. So this is way beyond anybody's, you know, affordability. The one of the senior analog engineers at Cambridge Consultants secretly bought one of these kits so he could learn about it. And everybody knew he bought it, but he didn't tell anybody he bought it. So he kind of knew that he'd spent the company's money and he was hoarding it, you know, sort of, and people all whispered about this evaluation kit that was secreted away so that this individual could learn about it. I thought, well, if that's what's going on, there's a market. So, you know, at home in my spare bedroom, sat on the floor in the classic sense, I put an evaluation kit together that would hit sort of a £50 price target, and figured I could write a nice little book that went with it, and it would add to the business that we had. And I put it together and made it, did some initial drafts of the self-instruction course that would go with it. And we're now in the middle of 1977, sort of roughly. So here I am with this very exciting piece of development, and it's quite clear the job that I'd accepted to go to, which was with the recently rescued British Leyland to bring technology to their vehicles in the Northwest, was I wasn't going to be able to do it from there. So I contacted Clive Sinclair and another Cambridge electronics company, and I said, look, I've developed this, are you interested? And Clive didn't come back, Chris Kerry came back and said, oh, can we meet and can you demonstrate it? So I kind of met with Clive and Chris at, sort of the pub at Bar Hill.
Mm-hmm. Does this actually bring back some memories if you have a look in these boxes?
Oh, you brought these up from downstairs. Yes, well, absolutely.
can you talk us through what these two different components are?
Straight to the camera. Yep. Okay. So this is the very original prototype that I put together on the floor of my spare bedroom. And that's the product that was eventually launched as the MK14 from Science of Cambridge. And if you've been an electronics engineer, you'll understand how you start with that and how you get to that. That in itself isn't difficult. It's interesting, what you can see with this is as it was put together, there was a calculator in here, and that calculator's gone missing over the years. And here on the large DIL is where the microprocessor was. It was a National Semiconductor SCAMP processor. And basically, it has 256 bytes of RAM, which is here. And then it had, this particular model has 512, but the kit was designed for 256. And then it had a electrically programmable read-only memory, which had 512 bytes, which is where the operating system sat. It had 8 bits of output, so you could turn things on and off. And you use the calculator keyboard and the calculator display to load the program.
And what could it do? What was it?
Not a lot. I mean, you could make a timer, you could play a simple game, you could do a random number generator, you could have a clock, you could do things that were quite challenging to program. And you had to program this in machine code. So you're telling the processor to move data from this register to that register, or from through the processing unit and then away back to a memory location. Every single step the processor takes, you have to tell it by a single instruction. So you've got to think about the architecture of the machine, what you're trying to achieve to drive something that is in the real world. Now, I actually, played not with this, but later on with this, sort of my infant son's toys, I managed to, make Lego go up and down from one of these things. And he still has a very clear memory later on with the very first Acorn keyboard machine, the Acorn Atom, of it being used, to control effectively a digger arm. And he could write a program, and he was probably at the time 7 years old, and he has this memory, and it probably is why he's an electronics engineer. It was there purely for the purpose of giving, it's a self-instruction kit to learn about programming and learn what's going on at the heart of a digital machine. And once you can do this, and once you can program this, you can program anything. You've got it. And one of my comments about computers today is it's so hidden behind the operating system and the protocols that the people generally, and kids in particular, haven't got the faintest idea what's going on. On the one of the workshops that we sponsor here, I sit in occasionally, and a very, very bright, precocious 9-year-old, came along. To this, and he knew everything. I mean, he knew the Raspberry Pi, he knew the dimensions and everything, but he didn't have any concept of what a byte was or a bit. He had no concept of a one and a zero, but he knew the gigabytes, he knew the processor speed, he had all of could say, well, you need this and this, but actually he didn't know what was going on at all. And I think that's one of the things that when this technology took hold, and particularly when the MK14 and then subsequently the Acorn and Sinclair machines spread, there were probably a couple of 100,000 people in the UK alone who were competent at processor level programming in the early 80s. I think if there's 100 people in the world who understand what's in an ARM core, that's probably too many. But what happens over time is the technology becomes less and less accessible, and to the point where it's a black box. Nobody ever looks at it. Nobody actually understands what's going on inside it. They only access it through emulators and high-level interpreters and so on. I'll let you have those two back in terms of memory lane behind it. So Chris was really interested. I did a deal with, he was running a spin-off company from Sinclair Radionics, which had been rescued by the National Enterprise Board, just like Leyland had. And they had a Mickey Mouse watch that they were selling. And he saw this as a really interesting product. Clive was much less interested in the product, although Clive did have interest. I developed a VDU display that went with it, and so the idea was there to go beyond it. And he was clearly interested in the further development in something that was more like a computer, but he had little interest in something that was just there as a training device. Mm. But Chris saw the opportunity. We signed a deal. I was to be paid quite a bit of money behind it, and I handed over the details to Chris and went off to my new job, And then I got a phone call from a very embarrassed Chris to tell me that they'd had the offer of a lifetime from National Semiconductor, who offered to give them their design, their operating system, in return for all of the chip supply on the kit, and they couldn't turn it down, it was too good. And Clive hasn't signed the agreement yet, so we're not going to honour it, type of thing. So these things happen. So inside, the MK14 isn't mine. It doesn't use my operating system. I've taken a lot of trouble to avoid using a noddy keypad, because I knew that that was going to be a real problem. And that was always the problem with the MK14. The keypad, and that particular model that you've just shown me, is a clear example. The membrane keypad isn't functional enough to enter code, and that was always the downfall of the MK14. But very quickly, probably within a year or 18 months, the next generation came along that overcome those issues. So Rodney and I wrote the book for the MK14 and got paid a lot of money by Clive for it. I read some other books, and it's an episode in my life that's interesting. So that's the MK14 story. And by then I'd moved on to a different world in Leyland.